Welcome to Interview from Mexico. I'm Laura Carlson, and I'll be your host as we look at the cutting-edge issues from the point of view of the men and women who know them best, here on Telesur. Today we're going to be talking about the growing problem of trafficking of women in Mexico. Estimates are that 3 people a day disappear in Mexico, most victims of sexual trafficking or sexual slavery, and mostly women and girls. Despite media attention to the issue, the on-the-ground response of the government has been insufficient, according to human rights organizations. To talk about this very serious crime, we're here in the offices of the Coalition Against Trafficking in Women for Latin America and the Caribbean. And we're very privileged to have with us today the director of the coalition, Teresa Ulloa. Teresa is an internationally recognized leader in the movement against trafficking. Teresa, thank you so much for being with us here on Interview from Mexico.
Thank you to you.
Teresa, I wanted to start out to see if you could give us an idea of the dimensions of this problem. How many cases are we talking about here in Mexico and in the region?
The governments don't have hard figures or reliable statistics. From what we have worked on, with the support of a demographer from the College of Mexico, we've done some projections. Because we can calculate that in Mexico and Latin America, it's largely undercover, because there's a huge number of unknown cases. This has to do with the high level of corruption or collusion that are hard to eradicate, and with the economic interests that involve political figures of the highest level or even the financial or business sector, because they make a huge profit. Also, we have a very serious problem, which is the neighborhood on the other side of the Rio Grande, which has the largest market for sex and drugs in the world, no? Sex for pay. In this measure, Mexico is like a filter. And we're a country of origin, transit, and destination. In the whole northern part, it's very hard to see how Americans cross over looking for sex, especially with girls or boys. In the zone of Cabo San Lucas, La Paz, and Ensenada, they come around this time of year, many retired men from the United States, and they rent houses near the ocean for the winter. They bring packages of used clothing, they bring a lot of toys and candy, and they use this to attract children to their rentals. This, for example, is a red flag for us. The projection that we have is more or less 500,000 victims in the entire region, in Latin America and the Caribbean. In Mexico, we still don't have reliable data. Since 2006, we implemented the Red Alert System, which has allowed us to have data, first just by publicizing it, then later we had to add the component of legal assistance and legal advising, later psychological attention, first for the family during the search, then to the women, and then to the emergency refuge. And we have a network of references and counter-references for shelters. We have the program of education, vocational training, and productive projects, and the transition homes that allows them to prepare to reintegrate into society. Based on this, we were able to generate a database, a system of statistical and geographically referenced information that became the first instrument with hard data on real cases. Well, we don't publish the names because we have to protect privacy, but behind each file, the authorities know there is a real case.
las autoridades saben que hay un caso real. Hemos estado rescatando.
We've been rescuing Venezuelans, Colombians, Dominicans, Argentines, and Mexicans too. Once we carried out a rescue, thanks to the Foreign Affairs Ministry of Argentina in New Delhi, of a Canadian woman and an Argentine woman.
So how exactly does this alert system work? As a mother, if my daughter's missing, I call you and the whole process begins. And about how many cases do you receive?
Yes, they call us or they send us an email. And last year we received 118 new cases when we had been receiving an average of 50-some. And this year we have about 55 so far. But this year has been especially difficult because we've had threats from a politician of the Institutional Revolutionary Party. They've come to the office to threaten us and left messages on my cell phone with rape threats. And this means that we have to design more sophisticated ways to filter the cases that we receive. But also, there's reduced financing. I imagine they want to silence us.
Get more about that particular case regarding the politician a little bit later. But I was wondering if you could describe some of the tendencies that you're seeing. Is there an indication that the number of cases are rising or falling, and are new forms of entrapment being employed?
I think so. There has been an increase in cases, at least in what I have the best measure for, which is Mexico. The profile generally in age, where we have the most cases, is 12 to 18 years. The method of recruitment of most of the victims is by force, followed by deceit, offering promises that are not kept, and at last, seduction. And in this, we have to be very careful because it's linked to getting them to fall in love through the social networks. Now, they don't even bother to go to the place to seduce them in person, but just use the social networks, and the girls walk right into the arms of the person who will exploit them. Fortunately, in the new law against trafficking, we achieved that consent on the part of the victim is not a defense against legal responsibility if there is any type of exploitation. Furthermore, prostitution in this country, like in all countries of Latin America, is obviously not a crime. What is a crime is to exploit women. What is a crime is to earn money at the cost of or any kind of benefit that derives from the exploiting the prostitution of another person. And we tried to cover, we still haven't managed it, the whole chain of exploitation, from the recruiter to the consumer.
Are there certain parts of the country where the trafficking of women and girls is particularly concentrated?
For us, there are two completely different things, human trafficking and trafficking by force. It's true that traveling as part of flows of irregular migration increases the risk of being captured or recruited into networks of human traffickers, but not necessarily. And here the problem is, we're talking about what part, because of course human trafficking has its components, just like drug trafficking or arms trafficking or the irregular trafficking of migrants. It has an origin, it has a transit route, and it has a destination, and it has a modality. Trafficking is not just sexual exploitation. Domestic slavery, sexual slavery, forced labor, forced servitude, trafficking in organs and body parts, using boys and girls under 18 for forced recruitment into organized crime, and now we're seeing an increase, for example, in the use of surrogate wombs. Couples from Canada and the United States come to Cancun, for example, and rent them because they can't have a baby. There are laboratories there that do in vitro fertilization and then implant the egg in the woman. The couples have called me because they say they have the woman in conditions of malnutrition and overcrowding and they need help.
We have to take a brief pause now. We'll be right back. We're back with Teresa Ulloa talking about the serious problem of trafficking of women and children. Teresa, I wanted to ask you, we talked a little about the Red Alert system. What other things is your organization doing to confront this problem?
Our work is based on the four P's. Those are our strategies. Prevention on all levels with schools, with students at all levels and all ages, with models of community and intervention. We design educational material and do a lot of activities around the issue of prevention. Although, unfortunately, when it comes to the budget for prevention, it does not reflect the commitment or the intention that it should. Due to the importance in the public agenda. Now we're concerned, for example, because they're going to give, or already gave out, to all fifth grade students in Mexico the famous iPads, and they have not designed them for the school curriculum so that they know that while internet can bring information and eliminate distances, which is marvelous, it also has its dark zones of high risk and there should be recommendations that they should be giving to girls and boys. So that's prevention. Protection and assistance, which is where the Red Alert system starts, all have a strong publicity component through social networks, through communication media, through the web page of the organization. We try to keep it very up to date and clean, and it is also linked to tweets and Twitter that I write or we send out to have better outreach. We did this year, for example, a very successful campaign that was launched only on March 8th against sexual tourism in the World Cup in Brazil. And a country that in 2012 included prostitution in its list of recognized employment, with an educational level between fourth and fifth grade of elementary school, something that we think violates all the international treaties that Brazil has ratified, because the only thing it has achieved with this is to encourage high levels of sex tourism and sex exploitation of girls and boys. In the map that UNICEF and CEPAL did recently, were really bad. Brazil, Argentina, Colombia, Mexico, and the Dominican Republic are identified as the worst countries for sex tourism. Later, we have the issue of prosecution. In the area of prosecution, that's where we provide legal support to make sure the culprits are punished and to assure that the crime is not repeated, and that includes integral justice. It's here where we have to spend a lot of time and effort, because I think it's part of how victims begin to empower themselves, to conceive of themselves as survivors. And we help to create action protocols, attention centers. We help and offer advice to design national programs, to change laws. We're working in 25 countries of the region through national networks.
Well, I saw a figure from your organization that some 98% of the cases in Mexico do not go through the justice system, that that's the level of impunity we have there. Why is this, and what can be done about that?
I think it's still not fully understood something that was really important, which was the reform to the first article of the Mexican Constitution, where international human rights treaties form an integral part of the Constitution in the first place. This was in 2011. 2012 was when the new law was passed, and I think that there hasn't been enough attention given to the training the individuals who are part of the justice system, and that is a task still pending. It's true that we have accomplished, little by little, increased sensibility in the way that crimes are proven. But we still have a lot of impunity. In fact, it has become so normalized, so naturalized in society, that the only thing that happened is that when the Mexican government stepped up its battle against drug trafficking, what the cartels did was to diversify their illicit activities. They went into extortion, kidnapping, arms trafficking, irregular trafficking of migrants, and sex trafficking. And they realized at once that it was a great business, infinite, that makes a lot of money with very little investment. If I were to take a dose of cocaine into the United States, or if anybody wanted to, I don't do it. In the moment of selling this dose of cocaine, I can sell it between $40 to $60, and then the transaction is over, yes? On the other hand, a girl, a teenager, a woman can be sold 10, 20, 30 times. We had a victim in New York who was sold 70 times a day, huh? She made $1,000 a day for the pimp, and she never saw a penny of it.
That's such a dramatic situation. We're going to take a short pause now, and we'll be right back. We're back in the offices of the Coalition Against Trafficking in Women, talking to the director, Teresa Ulloa. Teresa, you work with women and girls in high-risk situations, and yet you and your organization have also been receiving threats lately related to the case here in Mexico of Cuauhtémoc Gutiérrez, a ruling party leader in Mexico City who has been accused of running a prostitution ring. Can you tell us a little about this case?
It's a modus operandi that we can prove since 2002, when there were some girls who filed a complaint because they were fired for refusing to have sexual relations with him. Later, he continued to operate in the same way, and the next case is in 2011. And then recently, some announcements went out in El Universal, and some girls went to apply. But in the interview, also the announcements were deceitful because they said employment in government offices, and it turns out that a political party is an entity of public interest, but it's not a government office, even though its operations are funded with taxpayer money. And they went to a famous reporter and gave their testimony, and she decided to investigate. A reporter went undercover and went in as an applicant, and she managed to record almost the whole part where they explained what type of sexual relations she would have to perform if it was vaginal, it was with a condom. If it was oral, it was without a condom, and that she'd have to swallow the semen, and that all this was very normal, etc. And
Lo destituyeron.
And well, they fired him, or rather they suspended him temporarily. And then the Party of the Democratic Revolution filed charges against him, and we were working with three victims. We have more, but they are afraid to come out, and who in the end decided to file the charges. And now we are at an impasse as they define whether the Mexico City prosecutor is the office that should investigate or no. And meanwhile, they come to my house, the leaders of the PRI in Azcapotzalco. They came to the office, they came in with false names, telling lies, and they tried to drag me out of the office. Then they began to call the office almost daily and forcibly wanting to know the names of people who work here on cases that had nothing to do with trafficking. Then, starting May 10th, I began to receive coded messages, collect, on both of my telephones using sexual language that you could say were like threats of rape. We found bullet holes in the roof, and then lately, in September, first in a peaceful demonstration, where we tried to close, and in fact did close, the Electoral Institute of Mexico City. We were attacked by people who went to defend him. He and the party said they weren't involved, but we are sure that they are his people, that he sent them. We have the signs and videos where they yelled, "The women stand by Cuauhtémoc Gutiérrez." And they took down our banner. They surrounded us, and the police had to come in to get us out of there. And it's still going on, and I think it will continue to happen until the case is decided, and until we manage to break down all these walls of impunity that are protecting him.
Well, hopefully there'll be justice in this case and in so many more. Amid so much tragedy and bad news, we know that your organization has also had some major achievements. Can you describe for us a success story?
Yes, well, the Red Alert has led to the rescue of 1,337 and rescue or location because 5% were found dead. But we have one very successful case of two girls about 5 or 6 years old, twins, who are Luisa Fernanda, here above, and Luisa Maria. Their mother was in a situation of irregular migration in New York, and a Mexican exploited her sexually. They are the parents of the girls, but he beat her, and she got fed up and reported him. The judge ordered that once a week the father could see the girls. On one of those visits, he stole them and took them by land back to Mexico. Well, at first we didn't know that, but we managed to find out where he had the girls with the help of the National Attorney General's office. With only the telephone number of his family, we found them, we rescued them, and they were returned with their mother in New York City, where they receive and have received all the benefits of the Protection Act and U.S. residency. So they get the help from the United States that they need to move forward. With the cooperation of ICE and Sanctuary for Families in New York, which is the largest and most important organization that works on issues of trafficking, sex trafficking, and violence against women.
So your work often implies international cooperation.
I think that internal trafficking is like 150 or 200 times greater than international trafficking. What happens is that the government, in this simulation that there is here, well, doesn't want to look bad with other governments. So when there is a request for international cooperation, it places more emphasis on it. But for example, here in Chiapas, they still sell, or they still are accustomed to paying girls for, as brides, no? And many other manifestations of this that we have here in Mexico and in other countries within their own borders.
Thanks very much for your time and also for the work that you do. And thank you for joining us here on Interview from Mexico.